Good morning, and welcome to First Baptist Church, Panama City. I'm Sierra Hernandez, the Director of Daycare and Preschool Ministries here at First Baptist, and we would like to welcome you this morning. Ladies and gentlemen, children of all ages, come and support our First Kids and Preschool Ministries in their spring musical tonight at 5 o'clock p.m. in the Worship Center. First Kids will present The Greatest Hymn on Earth, and the Preschool Choir will present Song of Songs. The Primetimers Luncheon will be held this Thursday, May 9th at 10:30 in the Fellowship Hall. You don't want to miss this great time of fellowship. The Florida Worship Choir and Orchestra is coming to FBC on Friday, May 17th in the Worship Center. This team is comprised of worship pastors, senior pastors, choir and orchestra members, and praise team members from over 300 churches in Florida. Join us for an incredible night of music and worship as we praise the Lord together. Senior recognition will be Sunday, May 19th, during the morning worship service. Students, today is the deadline to sign up on our website, so be sure to register if you plan to participate. We look forward to celebrating this milestone in your life with you. Vacation Bible School is happening Monday, June 10th through Friday, June 14th from 9 o'clock to 12:30 for preschool through 5th grade. At Breaker Rock Beach, kids will learn to build their life on God's rock with solid truth in a world of shifting sands. To register your child or to sign up to volunteer, visit our website at firstbaptistpc.com/events. As always, don't forget to stay connected with us each week through our social media pages, our website, and stop by the Connect Desk in the lobby for service opportunities. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you. Thank you for that orchestra. As our men's quartet is coming out at this point, just want to welcome you today. Tonight, our children are going to be presenting the greatest hymn on earth, and you want to come back at 5 o'clock for that this evening. But this morning, we're going to do something a little bit different. We've got some hymns that are going to encompass through the 13th century all the way to the 20th century this morning, and we'll see how those musical forms and patterns and vocabulary have changed throughout the century. So it's going to be a great day of worship this morning. Let's welcome our quartet this morning as they share with us.
1, 2, 3.
Thank you for that, men. It's so good to see you here today in the house of the Lord. If you're a guest, you're joining us for the first or the second, maybe it's your third time. We're so glad that you're here, that you're worshiping with us this morning. I'll tell you what, there's an information card there, a little connect card in your seat back. If you take that, fill it out, drop it in the offering plate, or take it to our welcome desk at the back. We do have a gift for you. We're so glad that you're here, that you're worshiping with us today. Let's stand and greet those around you and welcome to the services here this morning.
Pattern for all preachers.
Amen. Thank you for singing. Well, back over in central Italy in the 13th century lived a man by the name of Saint Francis, and he preached a simple message, and it said this: Christ first, Christ last, Christ all in all. And the church during those times in the Dark Ages had become a dominant power, a dominant force in Europe. And due to songs being written that were heretical to the church, the Council of Laodicea banned church singing in the Dark Ages. Congregational singing was prohibited and only left to chancel choirs and priests. However, we know that true Christians can't keep from singing, amen? So he composed this hymn, this medieval hymn, in 1225 that derives from Psalm 148, and it says, "All creatures of our God and King." Let's sing that this morning. God and King. Well, it was by far that Martin Luther in the 1500s got the church singing again through the emergence of the printing press and inspired hymnals to be printed and published all throughout Europe. Now, notated as the father of English hymnody, Isaac Watts took and expounded upon hymns that would change the church forever. Hymns began to emerge with simpler meter and vocabulary. Watts said that Christian songs should express the thoughts and feelings of those who sang them. This English hymn was written in 1707 that Wesley once said, "I would trade all the songs I've written just had I composed." Amen. Powerful words. And into the 19th and 20th century, hymns once again changed forms, especially with the camp meeting movement and the Sunday school movement. The days of shape note singing began to flourish. Hymns now contained an added chorus or refrain, changing it from the hymn to the gospel song. Most of these types of gospel songs were introduced into the big revivals in America with Moody and Sankey, Billy Sunday, and Homer Rodover. The songs were exciting and usually had a mass choir backing them up, blessing together one from that era since Jesus came into the world.
Oh, Amen. Thank you, Brother Gary, and choir and orchestra. Thank you, quartet. You know, I was just thinking, I went to school and have 12 years of theological education, and I just learned more in 3 minutes about hymns than I learned in those 12 years. But that really adds to the meaning of the songs that we sing. And thank you, Brother Gary, for doing that. Of course, this is based on the theme of our children's musical tonight, and that is why Brother Gary wanted to focus our attention this morning on the hymns. But I want to remind you that tonight is our children's musical. I always ask you, and you always respond, to come back and support our kids. They work so hard during these months in preparation for the musicals, and we're never disappointed. They always do a tremendous job. I can say without apology, and I know I'm right, we have the best preschool and children's choir workers on the planet. And they work so hard in preparing our kids. And the way that we support our children and say thank you to them for all of these months of preparation is by us just showing up. So I know that you'll be here tonight to support them, and we appreciate that. Remember, this coming Wednesday night, we will resume our study, the fundamentals of our faith, in the fellowship hall. Started off with a bang here a couple of weeks ago. We're interrupted by our week of prayer last week. And by the way, that went amazing. We had hundreds and hundreds of people gathered together over this past week that were praying for our church, for one another, praying for our nation. And we're going to see the hand of God move as the result of those prayer meetings. And then finally, I want to encourage you to give me about 3 minutes of your time at the end of the service. I have something very important, special, and I think exciting to share with you as the church family. So when the invitation's given, don't get up and run out. Hang around, because I have some information that you as the church family need to hear this morning. Would you bow as we pray together? And Father, thank you, Lord Jesus, for the gift of music. Thank you, Lord, how our hearts are warmed and stirred within us as we sing the great songs of the faith, expressing the belief that we have in our hearts about you, O Father, the Lord Jesus, about the Holy Spirit, about the Word of God, about the church. God, thank you for this expression of worship that you have granted to us. Father, we pray that worship indeed will be our experience today. And we know that worship involves a lot more than just emotion. We know that worship involves our obedience. So I pray that as the Word of God is opened and proclaimed, that, Lord, when that invitation is given, that we will obey. God, if you say that we need to repent, that we would repent. Lord, if you tell us that we need to be saved, that we would be saved today. If you tell us that we need to join this church and become an active member of this body, getting the gospel out around the world, that, Lord, we would obey whatever it is, Holy Spirit, that you use through your word to touch our hearts today. We pray, God, that we would walk out of here walking in obedience. Help us to learn today. Learn something from your word that would help us to be the salt and the light. God, we continue to pray for our nation. God, we pray for repentance across our land. We pray for your world. We pray for your special chosen people, the nation of Israel. We pray, God, for your hand of protection upon them and for the peace of Jerusalem. Lord, we thank you for the privilege that we have today to give an offering, because you have blessed us with good health in which we can have jobs. And so we're grateful that as a part of our worship, now we give an offering to you. And we pray that those that are in charge of the monies in this church would be good stewards, use it wisely so that we can do what we've been called to do, be a great commission church, and proclaim the gospel around the world. In Jesus' name we do pray, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Amen. Thank you so much, choir and orchestra. And I tell you, I sure am glad that all of those singers up there are them and not me. With all of those parts that were going on at the same time, could you imagine Brother Rick and I being in the choir up there trying to sing? Man, you talking about a couple of confused dudes. We wouldn't have any idea what we were singing. But thank you so much, choir and orchestra. You have blessed us today. I invite you to open your Bibles, please, back to the book of Exodus, where we have been for quite some time now. I want you to find chapter number 4, and in just a moment, we're going to begin reading at verse number 18, Exodus chapter 4, verse number 18. Really, the past 48 years of my life could be entitled or summed up by the lessons I have learned. And I really could narrow that down, and I could talk about one subject matter concerning those lessons that I have learned. For the past 48 years, I have been saved. I've been trying to follow the Lord Jesus Christ as my Lord and my Savior. And during those 48 years, there has been one subject I have been consumed with, and that is knowing, doing, walking in, learning about the will of God. I have been just consumed. It's been a passion of mine. It is not something that I have arrived at, but it's something that I'm constantly learning about when it comes to the will of God. And friend, I want to tell you, there is nothing more exciting than doing the will of God. And there is nothing more fulfilling than learning new lessons about the will of God and then applying those lessons to your life. As we continue our study today on Moses, God's mighty man, I really pray that'll take place in this congregation of believers. I pray that we're going to learn some lessons about the will of God. We're going to apply them to our lives, and it will make a huge difference in the way that we seek to live the Christian life. Now, when we talk about the will of God, we know that oftentimes we make this statement that with age comes wisdom. Well, we're going to learn this morning from an 80-year-old man. His name was Moses. And some lessons that he's going to teach us about the will of God. So I want to talk to us today on the subject of practical lessons on the will of God. Exodus chapter 4, beginning with verse number 18. The Bible says, "So Moses went, and he returned to Jethro, his father-in-law. And he said to him, 'Please let me go and return to my brethren who are in Egypt, and see whether they are still alive.' And Jethro said to Moses, 'Go in peace.' Now the Lord said to Moses in Midian, 'Go, return to Egypt, for all the men who sought your life are dead.' Then Moses took his wife and his sons, set them on a donkey, and they returned to the land of Egypt. And Moses took the rod of God in his hand. And the Lord said to Moses, 'When you go back to Egypt, see that you do all of these wonders before Pharaoh, which I have put in your hand. But I will harden his heart so that he will not let his people go. And then you shall say to Pharaoh, Thus says the Lord, Israel is my son, my firstborn. So I say to you, let my son go, that he may serve me. But if you refuse to let him go, indeed I will kill your son, your firstborn. And it came to pass on the way at the encampment that the Lord met him, Moses, sought to kill him. And then Zipporah took a sharp stone and cut off the foreskin of her son and cast it at Moses' feet and said, surely you are a husband of blood to me. So he let him go. And then she said, you are a husband of blood because of the circumcision. And the Lord said to Aaron, go into the wilderness to meet Moses. So he went and he met him on the mountain of God and he kissed him. And so Moses told Aaron and all the words of the Lord who had sent him and all of the signs which he had commanded him. And then Moses and Aaron, they went and they gathered together all of the elders of the children of Israel. And Aaron spoke all of the words which the Lord had spoken to Moses. And then he did the signs in the sight of the people. So the people believed. And when they had heard that the Lord had visited the children of Israel and that he looked on their affliction, and then they bowed their heads and they worshiped. Now, the last time that we were together, we left Moses barefoot on the burning sands, standing before the burning bush, yielding his life to do the will of God. And we know that the will of God for Moses was for him to go back to Egypt, leave Midian, go back to Egypt, and he would be used as a tool in the hands of God to be the emancipator of the children of Israel. And I believe that at this point in the story of the life of Moses, that we learn some lessons that'll help us take our side alongside of Moses when it comes to doing the will of God. Now, I want to put a couple of verses up on the screens for you this morning. And I put these up here because I truly do believe that these two verses are what Moses experienced in doing the will of God. And I pray that these two verses will be our experience as well. Now, I would like to ask you, if you would, just to read out loud these verses along with me. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. I believe that those are two of the most instructive verses in all the Bible when it comes to you and I doing the will of God. And what is interesting is that we see two things here in these two verses about the will of God. Number one is that we see our part. Number two, we see God's part. What is our part? The Bible says that we are to trust in the Lord. That is that we are to rely upon Him. That is that we are to get out from behind the cockpit and allow Him to take the controls of our lives. We are to trust in the Lord. And we're not to do it half-heartedly. We're to do it wholeheartedly, because the Bible says that we're to do it with all of our hearts. He says that we are not to lean unto our own understanding. In other words, we are to get our direction, our guidance, our leadership from God through the Word of God. And then we are to acknowledge Him in all of our ways. That simply means that we are to live under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Friends, I want to tell you, apart from relying on the Lord, apart from removing ourselves from the control of our life, apart from getting our guidance from the Word of God, apart from acknowledging His Lordship over every area of our life, we don't stand a ghost of a chance of ever living in and doing the will of God. We are to acknowledge the Lordship of Christ in our life, in all ways, at the workplace, in school, at college, in our marriages, in our finances. We are to acknowledge the Lordship of Christ in every single area of our life. That is our part. Now, as we do our part, God does His part. What is His part? He says that He will direct our paths. And in the Hebrew, that simply means that He will smooth out the rough places. In other words, He will remove the obstacles that are standing in our way of doing the will of God. And what is so beautiful is that when these two things are harmonized, our part and His part, Proverbs 16 and verse number 7 happens. The Bible says, when a man's ways please the Lord, and when you're walking in the will of God, you are pleasing the Lord. When a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with him. That's what God does when we do our part. So what are some practical lessons here that we learn when it comes to doing the will of God? This is going to be one of the most practical sermons I have ever preached. I hope that you jot these things down, because I'm telling you, these things will help you. What are some practical lessons? First thing that we see is the relational lesson, the relational lesson. Down in verse number 18, so Moses, after he had heard from God at the burning bush, after he had heard God say, leave Midian, go back to Egypt, I want to use you to deliver my people. After he heard that, then Moses, verse 18, went and he returned to Jethro, his father-in-law, and he said to his father-in-law, please let me go and return to my brethren who are in Egypt and see whether they are still alive. And Jethro said to Moses, evidently that pleased him, because he said to him, go in peace. Now, we don't realize the tremendous transition that is about to take place in Moses' life. But also what we have to keep in mind is that Moses now has a family. Moses has a wife. Her name is Zipporah. He has two sons. And not only is this transition going to have a great impact on Moses' life, it's also going to have a great impact on his family's life. I mean, you think about Zipporah. She was born and raised in Midian. All of her roots were there. All of her family was there. All of her friends were there. And so evidently this whole idea of this relational lesson where family had to be involved in the will of God for Moses to be obedient to God is something that is extremely important to us. And I really think that when Moses went back to Jethro. See, not only was Jethro his father-in-law, but Jethro was also his employer. And when he went back to him, what Moses was saying by way of implication is that it was extremely important to me for my father-in-law to be on board. Now that leads me to the real practical lesson. And it's really a word for husbands and wives who are seeking to do the will of God. If you're listening, say amen. Husbands and wives that want to know the will of God. Husbands and wives that want to do the will of God. It is absolutely essential that both partners be on board when it comes to following the will of God for your life. In other words, husband or wife, you sense in your heart that God's speaking to you about something concerning the will of God. You need to share with your spouse what's going on. You need to talk to them about what God's doing in your heart. You need to tell them how it is that God is leading you. Because remember, they didn't stand before the burning bush, you did. They didn't hear the voice of God like you heard the voice of God. And I'm telling you this because I've seen it over and over and over again as a pastor. If there is relational conflict over the will of God, it will hinder you from doing the will of God in the future. And so that is why it is vitally important to always discuss what's going on with your mate concerning the will of God. Don't leave them out. For example, here is a family, and here is the man of that family, and that man feels like God's calling him to be a missionary, let's say. And God's made it clear to that husband, "It's my plan for your life. I want you to be a missionary." And it's so clear, God even tells him where he wants him to go. But he has not included his wife in that process. And so he comes home one night, foolishly, and he says to his wife, "Oh, by the way, God's calling me to be a missionary. And next Monday night, we are leaving for Siberia." Well, that would be foolish. I'm telling you, if God's stirring your heart, dear sir, if God's stirring your heart, dear ma'am, about a particular thing pertaining to the will of God, don't keep that from your mate. Share it with them. Karen and I have experienced three major moves in following the will of God. The first major move was when we left Hilliard, Florida, and we moved to Dothan, Alabama, to go to school in Graceville, Florida. And I want to tell you, from the very moment that I felt like God was calling me to preach, I began sharing that information with my wife. And so when we left to go to Bible college, we were both on board. And then we graduated from Bible college, and I felt God moving my heart to New Orleans Seminary. And I shared that information with my wife. And we ended up moving to Gulfport, Mississippi, where I pastored a church for the next 13 years, and both of us were on board with that. And then when we moved from Gulfport, Mississippi to Panama City, where we've been since, and the place where I'm going to die, because I'm too old for anybody else to take me, we were on board with that. What I'm saying, dear friends, and listen carefully, when it comes to the will of God and there's a family involved, God will work unity in both of those hearts. And if God doesn't work the unity, and the unity is not there, and both are not in agreement, you can just chalk it up. That's not the leadership of the Lord. That's not the will of God. And so we learn the relational lesson. Second lesson we learn is the assurance lesson. I don't read the verses yet, but down in verses 19 through 23, we see the assurance lesson. And what is such a blessing is to realize that when the Lord sent Moses out, he sent him out by encouraging him with four assurances in his life that he could cling to when times got difficult. Now, why do I bring this out, and why are these assurances so possible that I believe oftentimes God gives to us on the very front end of us stepping out in faith and following the will of God? Why is it so important? Because to do the will of God requires faith. Why does it require faith? Because never does God at the very beginning give us all the details. Never. I have never met anyone that God revealed his will to and they knew every single detail of what was going to happen. So they had to walk in faith. And you see, as you're making your journey and you're walking in faith, what do? You cling to these assurances that God gave you. So what kind of assurances did God give to Moses that encouraged him to do the will of God? First of all, he gave him a promise down in verse number 19. "Now the Lord said to Moses in Midian, 'Go return to Egypt, for all the men who sought your life, they are dead.'" I'll guarantee you, when Moses first heard the call of God, his thought was, "But God, you don't understand what's waiting for me back in Egypt." Remember, he had a price on his head. Remember, he killed the Egyptian, and he was probably on the most wanted list of the Egyptian FBI. And God, you want me to go back there? And so God gave him that wonderful promise. And that promise was that all the men who sought your life, they are dead. Reckon that promise ministered to his heart as he was on his way to do the will of God, heading back to Egypt. I tell you another thing that I think that really spoke to Moses' heart. When God told him this, Moses had fear in his heart. I don't want to go back there. They're going to take my life if I do. And I believe that this told Moses, you know what? God knows what's in your heart. God's concerned about what you're concerned about. And I believe that even though these words would not have been written until New Testament days, when Simon Peter wrote in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 7 that you can cast all your cares upon him, knowing that he cares for you, I really think that those were the words that were on Moses' heart and mind. You know what? God knows about my fear. He knows about my worries. He knows about my anxiety. Friend, let me ask you, has God been leading you to do something lately? Have you been sensitive to the leadership of the Lord lately? Have you been responding to the nudging of the Holy Spirit in one direction in your life lately? And as you have and you've begun to step out in faith, all of a sudden worry and anxiety and fear begins to raise its ugly head in your heart. Friend, if that's you, claim the promise Moses claimed. That I can cast all my care upon him, knowing that he cares for me. So he gave him a promise. He also gave him a presence. Down in verse number 20, then Moses took his wife and his sons. He set them on a donkey. He returned to the land of Egypt. And Moses took the rod of God in his hand. That rod was nothing more than a shepherd's staff. The rod of God. And I go back to verse number 2. Same staff is mentioned. So the Lord said to him, what's that in your hand? And he said, a rod. Verse 2, it's a rod. Verse 20, it's the rod of God. What happened between verse 2 and verse 20? A miracle. Verse number 3 of chapter 4, he said, cast it on the ground. So he cast the rod on the ground. It became a serpent. Moses fled from it. Then the Lord said to Moses, reach out your hand, take it by the tail. And he reached out his hand and he caught that serpent and it became a rod in his hand. That was a miracle. When Moses stepped out in faith and grabbed that serpent that one time was a stick and it turned back into a stick, that was a miracle of God. In other words, God was in that rod. You know what this was assuring Moses of? This was a tangible reminder of the presence of God. Everywhere Moses went in fulfilling the will of God, walking through Egypt, he had that rod in his hand, and it was a visible reminder. I am not in this alone. Friend, let me tell you something. The safest place you can be is in the center of the will of God. Because when you are doing the will of God, you have God's protection, you have God's provision, because you have God's presence. It's amazing how God will give us something to hold on to. Now, it's a verse you all know well. But when Karen and I left Hilliard, Florida, God gave us a verse we lived on, we stood on. It anchored our lives. That verse was Isaiah 41, verse 10. Do not fear, for I am with thee. Do not be dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. And friend, I can't tell you how many times there were when there wasn't enough money at the end of the month, when we did not know what was going to happen the next day. I can't tell you the numbers of time that Isaiah 41, verse 10, ministered to our hearts. See, dear friends, that was a promise of the presence of God. If you step out to do the will of God, friend, you're going to need more than your ability, more than your wisdom, more than your good looks. You're going to need an assurance of the Lord. And there is no assurance like the presence of the Lord. But then he gave him a prediction down in verse number 21. And the Lord said to Moses, "Now when you go back to Egypt, see that you do all of these wonders before Pharaoh, which I put in your hand. But I will harden his heart so that he will not let the people go." Now in that little phrase, "I will harden his heart," two things are communicated. Number one, God was in control. God was in control. I want to tell you, if you're interested in the will of God, you won't do it unless you're convicted that God is in control. And number two, you'll face opposition. That's what he told Moses. God's in control, but understand, the will of God's not going to be easy. You're going to face opposition. Are you beginning to understand now why it is so vital to be convicted about the presence of God? If you're going to face opposition, you better know that you are not in it alone. And I know what everybody in here is wanting me to do today, and that is explain verse 21. "But I will harden his heart." And I'm going to deal a lot more in depth with this the further along that we go in the study. But suffice it to say, I will not settle in 5 minutes what theologians have argued about for 200 years. So I just acknowledge that up front. But I'm coming back to it later. I really am. So if you don't hear what you want to hear, don't come outside and rebuke me after the service. You just hold on until we finish the study. But I do want to stop, and I want to say right here that anyone who looks at this subject of God hardening his heart, anyone that looks at this subject, whether they are a Calvinist, whether they are an Arminian, or whether they are someone like me that is an in-betweener, anyone that looks at this subject without looking at it from a balanced perspective will tip their theological scales to an unhealthy side. I discovered something that was interesting to me. In all of these chapters, I think it's 8 chapters in Exodus that's dealing with this area. Pharaoh's heart being hard is mentioned 40 times. And what is so interesting is that there's a perfect balance. 20 times it talks about God hardening Pharaoh's heart. 20 times it talks about Pharaoh hardening his own heart. There is that perfect balance between the two. Now, you've been here long enough to know that I've always taught us when we study the Bible, study it contextually, right? We don't want to just pull a verse out without studying it contextually. So you cannot read verse 21 where God says, "But I will harden his heart," without reading chapter 3, verses 16 through 19. Where he said, "And go and gather the elders of Israel together. Say to them, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, appeared to me, saying, I've surely visited you, and I've seen what is done to you in Egypt. And I have said that I will bring you up out of the affliction of Egypt to the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Jebusites. I'm going to bring you to a land that's flowing with milk and honey. Then they will heed your voice, and you shall come, you and the elders of Israel. You shall come to the king, that's to the Pharaoh of Egypt, and you shall say to him, the Lord God of the Hebrews has met with us. And now please let us go 3 days' journey into the wilderness that we may sacrifice to the Lord our God. I hope I'm not putting you asleep, but look at verse 20, verse 19. God says, but I am sure. Why can God say that? Because God knows all things, right? He knows the end from the beginning. God says, but I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go, nor enter by a mighty hand. Now, before he said what he said in chapter 4, verse 21, about him hardening Pharaoh's heart, he said what he said in chapter 3, verses 16 through 19, that Pharaoh's heart was already hard. In other words, Pharaoh had made up his mind. Pharaoh's will was set. That's what he's saying here. And so before I go further later on in the study, let me just stop and say right here that to use this as an illustration, as a proof text of unconditional election to salvation, which ends up with double-edged predestination, that God chooses some to be saved, He chooses others to be lost, that God basically hardens the heart of a person from the womb so that they cannot believe because they are not one of the chosen. And I'm not going to argue all that stuff out, but I'm here to tell you that to use that as a proof text for unconditional predestination when it comes to salvation is doing a terrible job of exegeting the text in context. That is not what it is saying. I'll say more about that later, but I just simply want to make the practical application. The practical application is there are mysteries about the will of God. There are mysteries about the ways of God. Friend, I want to tell you, verse 21 is really a head scratcher when you think about it. God said, I'm going to harden his heart. He's not going to let him go. But now, wait a minute. He just called an 80-year-old man to go to Pharaoh and said, now I want you to tell him, let my people go. But oh, by the way, he's not going to do it. Explain that to me. You can't. Kind of reminds me of Romans chapter 11, verse 33 and 34. Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and the knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and his ways. They are past finding out. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has become his counselor? Friend, has that been your experience in seeking to know and to do the will of God? That I just can't wrap my mind around it all? Sometimes it just seems illogical. It seems to defy common sense. I mean, I just can't explain his will and his ways fully and completely. No, Pastor, that's never been my experience. But I would say you've never sought to do the will of God. Because if you have, sometimes it's going to be a real head scratcher as to what's going on. Didn't Isaiah the prophet say over in Isaiah chapter 55, verses 8 and 9, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor my ways your ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways. And my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. God said, I'm God, you're not. And you're not always going to understand everything fully and completely. It was such a liberating day in my life when I came to the conclusion, I don't have to explain everything about God and about His ways and about His will. God said, Moses, you don't have to understand why this is happening. All that I'm telling you to do is do it. I know that doesn't make sense. You go and you give Him this message, He's not going to respond, but you do it anyway. It makes no sense. But Moses, that's all I ask you to do is obey me. The great John Walford, I have a lot of his books in my library. Former president of Dallas Theological Seminary used to say, We spend too much of our time trying to unscrew the inscrutable. Good advice. Too much of our time trying to figure out what is beyond the mind of puny man, rather than just doing the things that we can understand. And then he gave him, fourthly, the assurance of peace. Now, back in verses 22 and 23, and I want to tell you, we just cannot underestimate the courage that it took for Moses to do what he did in verse 22 and 23. You shall go to Pharaoh, and you shall say to him, Israel is my son, my firstborn. So I say to you, let my son go, that he may serve me. That's Israel. But if you refuse to let him go, God said, you tell him indeed that I am going to kill his son, his firstborn. Boy, that took courage. We're talking about going before the most powerful man in the world. That would be like me walking into Joe Biden's office and say, sir, you're going to hell. That's the kind of courage that it took there. But God gave him a peace in his heart. And the way that I know God gave him a peace, when you read the story, he didn't even flinch. He just walked in there and he told him that. How could he do that? He was in the will of God. And friend, it's been my experience, when you are operating in the will of God, God's going to give you peace. In spite of the difficulties, in spite of the circumstances, in spite of the obstacles, there's going to be a peace there. But I want to say to you today that if there is this constant raging turmoil in your soul, when you're doing what you're doing, that's a pretty good indication that you are not in the will of God. Because when you are in the will of God, you're going to have a peace. You know, there are times when I'm preaching sermons kind of like this one, and I think, you know what, I'm really not communicating. I can see people nodding off and sleeping. They're not listening. I'm making no sense. Nobody's paying attention. But let me tell you what I've got. I got such a peace in my heart because I know right now I'm in the center of the will of God. And that's what God always does for His children. He gives them this peace that passes all understanding. But I'm telling you, if you go to teach that class and you just can't wait until it's over, try to preach that sermon, you can't wait till, man, finally it's over and I can go home and get out from underneath this pressure. You probably ought to check yourself. Are you really in the center of the will of God? Because God will always give us a peace. But then the third lesson, I got to hurry, the obedience lesson. I'm always in a hurry when I'm preaching. The obedience lesson. Now, let me just mention this without going into too much detail. The first practical lesson when it comes to doing the will of God, knowing it, carrying it out, living in it, from this text, is that we need to look deeply. Look deeply. Verse 24, it came to pass On the way of at the encampment that the Lord met him, Moses, and the Lord sought to kill him. Then Zipporah, his wife, she took a sharp stone, cut off the foreskin of her son, and cast it at Moses' feet, and said, "Surely you are a husband of blood to me." Now, something happened along the journey, and there was a confrontation. God met Moses and evidently inflicted him with some kind of a sickness that was about to take his life. And his wife, Zipporah, recognized what was happening. And it was because Moses was living in disobedience. He had not circumcised his boys. And so she took a sharp stone, circumcised the son, threw the foreskin at Moses' feet, because she recognized what was happening was Moses had been living in disobedience. Now, we don't know why Moses had disobeyed the Lord. We do know that circumcision was extremely important. We do know that circumcision was one of the most important rites of Judaism. That was what marked the Jewish boys as being the chosen people of God. It was not a small issue. But for some reason, Moses had not done that. Now, don't miss the principle. The principle is Moses on his way to do the will of God, a big-time feat, delivering the children of Israel. God stops him in his tracks, and God says, "Moses, before you take one more step, you need to obey me in this area of your life." See, Moses just swept that under the rug. Moses had forgotten all about that. But God said, "Before you put one foot in the palace, you better obey me." Now, friend, God has a way of doing that. And when you ever get to the place in your life where you're saying, "I am ready to surrender to the will of God. I am sick and tired of living with my toes in the shallows. I want to dive into the deep end. I'm so tired of just coming to church on Sunday, looking spiritual, while the rest of the week I live my life to please me." When we make that commitment, God has a way of uncovering what we have covered. And I'm telling you, God's pretty good at uncovering the stuff we have swept under the rug. And so when we say, "I want to do the will of God, I want to preach the gospel, I want to be a worship pastor, I want to do this, I want to do that, I want to do this," then God will begin to uncover things that we need to repent of before we can go further in doing the will of God. God will knock on the door of your heart, "But God, I'm not interested in that." God says, "But I am. You remember what you have swept under the rug. I've uncovered it. Now you need to confess it." And friend, I want to tell you, when we get to that point, we'll start praying like the psalmist, Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24. "Search me, O God, know my heart. Try me, O God, and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." That'll become the prayer of our lives. So look deeply. And then secondly, listen carefully. Now here's a word for married spouses. There is no better person in the world to listen to concerning the will of God, if you have a godly spouse, than your spouse. One of the greatest resources we have in knowing and doing the will of God is a godly spouse. It is so interesting here. She called Moses a bloody husband. You say, Pastor, you don't know how my wife talks about me. Has she called you a bloody husband lately? But there is nothing in the text that would indicate he rebelled against that. He received that criticism. He was open to it. Know what I've discovered? I've discovered that Christian men and women who come to church on a regular basis, who serve the Lord, are open to advice, wisdom, criticism from everybody under the sun, but the one who knows them best and loves them most. Did you realize that your spouse knows you a lot better than your pastor does? Your spouse sees the blind spots that you have. And we are fools when we will not listen to the critique of our spouses. I want to tell you, if you say that you're spiritual, and you want to be spiritual, and you want to do the will of God, you'll go home today and you'll give your husband or wife the freedom to point out things in your life that need correction. And oh, by the way, kind of operates both ways. If you hand out the criticism, you got to be willing to receive it. If all you want to do is be hypercritical of your spouse, but not hear anything they have to say, not going to work. I really believe what I'm saying right now could transform Christian families if we would just do this one thing. God, I want to do your will. And God says, look, I've planted in your home a godly man or a godly woman. Listen to them, Bubba. Listen. Pay attention to what they have to say. Listen carefully. And then, I know time's getting away, but this is vital, the companion lesson. The companion lesson. Verse 27, and the Lord said to Aaron, go into the wilderness to meet Moses. So he went and he met him on the mountain of God and kissed him. So Moses told Aaron all of the words of the Lord who had sent him and all of the signs which he had commanded him. Can you imagine what a reunion this must have been? 40 years these brothers had not seen each other. And now they have this amazing union. But back to the practical lesson in doing the will of God. Here it is. Two are better than one. Two are better than one. When Jesus sent the disciples out, how did he send them? In pairs. When the first missionaries were sent out of the church in the book of Acts to go take the gospel to the Gentiles, who did God send? Paul and Barnabas. Two are better than one. Moses was on his way to do the will of God. But Moses, at this point, Moses was alone. How do we know that? Because after the circumcision, his wife Zipporah had taken the boys and had gone back home to Midian. According to Exodus chapter 18, verse 2, then Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, took Zipporah, Moses' wife, after he had Moses sent her back. Maybe they went back to take care of their boys from surgery of circumcision. I don't know. All I know is Moses was alone, and God said, this is not good. Moses knew that on that journey, he was going to need encouragement and challenge. So God sent him a brother, his own biological brother. But let me just stop and ask, men, do you have a soul brother? Or are you out there on an island? A real soul brother that you can share your heart with. disappointments with, failures with, mistakes with, sins with. Ladies, do you have a real soul sister? Someone that will encourage you along the way and help you and strengthen you? Or maybe you say, well, Pastor, I'm too spiritual for that. I don't need that. Well, I want to tell you, you did just not reveal your spirituality if you responded like that. Because what you're saying is, I'm better than Moses. Moses needed a companion. So do you. So do I. We all need that. That's why we make a big deal out of small groups around here, to get together with people who will hold us accountable, who will rebuke us if necessary, who will challenge us, who will guide us. And so Moses needed a companion, the companion lesson. If you don't have a soul brother or soul sister, can I plead with you to do something? Ask God to give you one. He will. Just ask the Lord to raise up somebody in your life that can meet that need. I close with this, and that is the fruit lesson. The fruit lesson. Verse 29, then Moses and Aaron, they went and they gathered together all of the elders of the children of Israel. Aaron spoke all the words which the Lord had spoken to Moses. Then he did the signs in the sight of all the people, and then marked this, so the people believed. The people believed. Latter part of that verse, they bowed their heads and they worshiped. One of the best proofs there is that we are in the will of God is fruit. Transformed lives. They believed what Moses said. There was fruit. My experience with this comes from my first sermon that I ever preached. I think I've told you the story, but I wrestled with the call of God on my life for 5 years. My pastor, who was my father-in-law, got sick of hearing it. So one day I was in his office, once again whining about not knowing what the will of God was for me to preach or not. He said, well, we're going to put an end to it. And he reached over and pulled out his desk drawer, pulled out his calendar, and said, 3 weeks from today, this Sunday night, you got the sermon. Those were the three most miserable weeks I have ever lived. I couldn't eat, drink, I couldn't sleep. It was horrible. And I'm telling you, I remember it like it was yesterday. That Sunday afternoon, I didn't eat any lunch. I just went in the backyard, which was out in the woods in Hilliard, and I walked around and talked to the squirrels. I don't know what all I did, but it was horrible. I had my sermon all prepared, Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. Lasted 8 minutes. You've come a long way, Pastor. 8 minutes. I exhausted everything I'd studied in about 4 minutes. I went back to my daily Bible reading in the book of Genesis and picked up some stuff just to try to fill in the gap and make it a little longer. But I know that the Lord was tired of my lack of faith. But I said, Lord, I pray, if this is your will for my life, I pray that I will see you transform somebody tonight. And after that mess that I had made, I gave the invitation, and a young man is probably mid-20s. His name's Billy. Billy came forward, tears in his eyes, and gave his heart to Jesus. I said, Lord, that's a miracle. How in the world did that happen? And God said, oh, Craig, it was me. It wasn't any of you. What I'm saying is that God, let me see fruit. And friend, when you're doing the will of God, God's going to let you see fruit. Transform lives from that. Are you doing the will of God today? That's all I'll ask. If you're not saved, you're not in the will of God. Because the Bible says it's not God's will that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. If you're not actively involved in a local church, you're not in God's will. God saved you, gifted you. He wants to use you. If you've not been baptized since you've believed, you're not in God's will. If God's speaking to your heart about whatever, our ministers are going to be down front to help you, to pray with you, to pray for you. The altar is available, but I ask you to come. Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed. Father in heaven, I thank you in Jesus' name for this amazing text of Scripture and the many lessons we learn about your will. May we apply to our lives what you have touched us about. To think that the God of heaven would include us in doing his will on earth is humbling and profound. May we not take it lightly in Jesus' name. Heads bowed, eyes closed, would you come?
Saved to unite with our church family.
Just that.